I love using this node. Let's dive in and check it out.
Pyro Solver. The new Pyro Solver has made using it so much easier. It's now organized from left to right and has a host of handy features. Before we dive in, please note that I'm not a VFX artist, but rather a motion designer who loves playing with Pyro. So many of the examples I share will not be VFX approved, but let's take a look at this awesome node. To get started, we'll create a really simple test scene. First, we'll create a sphere. We'll set it to polygon and increase the frequency so that we have something a little bit more high res. Next, I'm going to create an attribute adjust color set to noise and inferno. We can also animate this noise. We'll use this color later on to showcase how to source in color. Now we'll use a pyro source. We'll use the initialize buttons to source both smoke and color. Next, we'll use a volume rasterize attributes. This is to convert point attributes into VDB attributes, which is what the pyro solver needs. Now we can plug this into the pyro solver. We're ready to go. Currently, it's set to run in sparse mode, which is the default. I'm going to switch this to OpenCL. As you'll notice, my bounding box needs to be altered. I can adjust it in the bound tab, but I can also use these quick setups to create a reference bound box that I can use to adjust, which I find a lot easier. These quick setups are amazing and make setting up smoke simulations so much faster. Let's take a quick look at some of them. The initialize buttons just initialize the sourcing tab with the correct attributes. It'll also adjust the fields and look tabs for you. This is an awesome way to quickly get setups going. Add color source lets you bring in a CD attribute from your sourced object. So now we can use the color from our attribute adjust color in our smoke sim with just one click. By clicking the setup SDF collisions, it'll create a VDB from polygons, which you can now plug in your polygon geometry. It'll do the rest for you. Amazing. By clicking create lights, it'll pop up some options that you can use to quickly set up lights to enhance the look of your simulation. Create lights and camera will set up all you need to render in Mantra. It'll enable motion blur and whatever else is needed. Create render state will do exactly as it did before, but for Karma and LOPS. Obviously, this is amazing as you can quickly get your Pyro simulations into Karma. Sharpen volume sharpens your volume. This is handy if you want to do a slightly lower res simulation and then get a little bit more detail back post sim. Cache simulation drops down a file cache. Now onto the other settings. The voxel size will change the resolution of your Pyro sim. Smaller numbers mean higher resolution and slower simulation times. The simulation type by default is set to sparse. This will solve only the areas that need to be solved, making it very memory efficient. Minimal OpenCL runs entirely on the GPU and is very fast, but is limited to the amount of VRAM you have. So while fast, it doesn't scale very well. Dense mode is the slowest. However, when you have multiple smoke simulations that you want to interact with one another, this is still probably the best mode to use. Switching between these is totally acceptable, so setting everything up in minimal OpenCL and then switching to sparse with a low voxel size is often a great way to work. Jumping onto the bound tab, the bound is the red box that appears in our viewport. In OpenCL mode, anything outside of the bounds will be cut off. Setting this to an appropriate size is important as it'll save simulation times. The boundary conditions let you create solid walls at your boundary limits. This gets some really nice interaction with a collider type boundary. With this mode turned to open, the power simulation will just disappear when meeting the boundary. In sparse mode, this resizing tab holds the attributes the solver will use to adaptively resize the bounding box. In general, this can be left at default. Sourcing frame range lets you control emission, so you can do cool bursts instead of constant emission. You can also do a cycle length and do repetitions of your simulation. The source volume section is where you'll bring in the attributes you want the Pyro Solver to source. You can manually add them or use the quick setups dropdown. Collisions will let you source in collisions. You can also activate or deactivate them, which is really handy. The field guides are just visualizations. These are really handy when you want to visualize different attributes. Switching between the 2D and 3D views is great. Density dissipation reduces density over time. Higher values means the smoke will disappear faster. Lower values means the opposite. The smoke will basically last forever. An important checkbox is this emit density from flame. This will emit density based on a burn attribute. So this will create smoke from a flame rather than from your source. Turning up the emission scale helps increase the amount of smoke. Jumping down to the flame value, this will dictate how long the flame lives through your simulation. A really low value will have a short lifespan and emit mostly smoke, whereas a higher value will have the flame continue through the simulation, combining it with the smoke. The shape tab is where most of the fun happens. You can get all sorts of amazing control with your pyro setups. Buoyancy is basically how much it'll rise due to the calculation of temperature and density. Lower values will cause it to rise a lot more slowly. The wind will add a unified wind across the simulation. Disturbance adds really cool noise-like effects without altering the general movement of the simulation. Turbulence is similar to disturbance in that it adds noises, but this is usually best used for big noises to break up the overall shape. Shredding is much the same, adding some nice noise breakup to your simulation. Viscosity keeps adjacent voxels moving in the same direction. A value of 0 will allow a more chaotic simulation, whereas increasing this value will give a nice smoother look. Obviously, combining all these effects can get you some great artistic control. When using OpenCL mode, you can update these on the fly, seeing the results in near real time, which is super fun. The look tab lets you dial in the look of your simulation. Smoke affects the smoke in your scene. You can increase the density scale to make it thicker smoke. You can also change the colors of both the smoke color and the shadow color. Fire will introduce fire emission into your simulation. You can increase or decrease your intensity scale to add or reduce fire intensity. I prefer to bypass the look in the Pyro Solver and use the new Pyro Bake volume instead. I find this node gives more control and has some really great quick setups to get an amazing looking simulation super quickly. Finally, we can export attributes from the Pyro Solver. If you're like me, one of the main reasons I use Pyro is to steal the velocity attribute and use it to affect other simulations. I find this is the best way to get really organic simulations. So let's take a look at an example of this. In this scene, I created a Pyro setup, much like the beginning of the video, using a sphere, a Pyro source, and a volume rasterize attributes. The only thing I added was a point velocity to give it an initial strong downward force. In the Pyro Solver, I played with the settings until I found something that I thought looked nice. In the Bound tab, I used Closed Below so that I could get some nice interaction with the floor rather than the smoke just disappearing. In the Fields tab, I reduced Dissipation so my smoke lasted longer and didn't disappear so quickly. In the Shape tab, I inverted the buoyancy by flipping the gravity acceleration. I added some turbulence and also some shredding. These values were just a matter of trial and error. I then created a tube. I increased the radius scale, reduced the height, and also gave it end caps. I used a match size to place it on the ground. Then I used the points from volume to fill it with points. I used a value of 0.02 and I turned up the jitter scale to 1 so I didn't have uniform pattern of points but rather just a pile of points. I then created a pop net and I fed my points into input 1 and my pyro into input 2. Inside the popnet, I used all points and used first context geometry so it referenced the first input of my popnet, which is all my points. In the birth tab, I used an expression $FF equal equal 1. This just means that it'll emit the points only on frame 1, so there won't be a constant emission of points. I then created a ground plane and merged it into my simulation. Now if I hit play, nothing happens. What I want now is a pop advect by volumes. This will use the velocity field from a Pyro simulation to advect or move my points. I'll change the source to second context geometry as this is where I plugged in my Pyro simulation. I'll also change the advection type to update velocity. Now when I hit play, I get this really cool shockwave of particles. Post simulation, you can use a copy to points node to copy some fragments or noised up spheres, and you can get some really great looking simulations. The Pyro Solver is such fun and so intuitive to use now. I hope you're ready to get your hands dirty. Time to open Houdini and make some smoking goodness.